Good morning, welcome out to church this morning. It's great to be back. I just want to thank everybody for praying for us for safe travels, and it was a very good time. Aaron and Anna are not here this morning, but they asked for prayer for them. So if you please remember them in prayer today. They're down sharing the gospel with the friends in the Twin Cities area, and one he said has MS, and the other one has prostate cancer. So they're down there sharing the gospel with them. So he would just ask for prayer for the family members, and he asked for prayer for them, that the Lord would give them the words. And then on my friend from work, or my previous work, his dad, Gary Adams, is not doing well. So we just asked to pray for Gary and Dave. And we have Pastor Benjamin not doing well, so if you could keep him in prayers, congested heart failure, and keep him in prayer for sure. We also have our kids going back to college. We want to pray for them. And then if you could remember Jack Maddie in prayer. Jack Maddie went through boot camp in the Navy. He actually graduated, and now he's in Texas and continues to... we miss his mom and dad, so we just want to keep him in prayer, and we need to pray for his mom and dad also, because they miss their son. And we have Tyler Engelbrett. He's still in Chicago, so we want to continue to keep him in prayer. Any other prayer requests this morning? Okay, let's open with a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, first of all, we just want to thank you for Christ. We're so thankful that you sent your only begotten Son to the cross of Calvary, to die on the cross for the sins of mankind, past, present, and future, and then buried, showing all of mankind that he paid the payment for sin. And then he resurrected for our justification, showing us the payment for sin is paid in full. And when we believe that, we trust in Jesus Christ as our Savior, we become born again, becoming a child of God forever by the finished work of Jesus Christ. And so, Father, we're just so thankful for this privileged position here today, that we can sit here today and call us the children of God, all by faith in what Jesus Christ has done for us. And we're so thankful for that. And, Father, as we gather here today, we pray for people to hear the gospel and accept Jesus Christ. They would receive Christ and become born again themselves, knowing they have eternal life, knowing that they're going to forever spend eternity in heaven, and with a new glorified body, and forever in the presence of our Lord Jesus Christ, our Savior. And that is a wonderful thing to look forward to. That is the hope that you've given us throughout the day. So, Father, we just pray for the people on the list, that they would hear the gospel and receive Christ. We pray for all the ministries that go out to the jail, the nursing homes, senior centers, the youth group, and all the other ministries that we have. And we're just so blessed to have those ministries, and we're so blessed to have men and women out there sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ. And Father, we pray for Lauren and Nancy. We just pray, friends of Aaron and Anna's, we just pray, first of all, that you'd give them the words and compassion towards Lauren and Nancy, and that Lauren and Nancy would receive Christ this morning. We just pray that you'd give them the words this morning, give them the knowledge and understanding, and that you'd be with them, and that these people would receive Christ. And we pray for Gary Adams, and we just pray that he would receive Christ, Father. We know that the gospel has been shared with him. I hope he's accepted as Christ as his Savior. But we pray that he'd be pain-free during his last times here, last days here, last weeks here on earth. And, Father, we just pray that you'd be with my friend Dave, and that you'd continue to comfort him through this tough times. We know he loves his dad very much. Father, we pray for Pastor Benjamin, a believer in Christ, and somebody's out there sharing, defending the gospel. And Father, we just ask that you be with him, and we know it's your will, Father, but we just ask that we know he's the one that kind of holds things together over there, and we just pray that you'd be with him, and you'd heal him, Father, and that you continue to give him the strength to continue to move forward and get that island of Mindanao saved, that everybody would hear the gospel over there. And Father, we just continue to pray for Jan Patterson. We just pray that you continue to give her strength and comfort, and we're so joyful for the baby, the miracle baby, and we're just so thankful for that, Father. And Father, we pray for our kids going back to college. We pray that you'd be with them, and that you'd keep them surrounded, a hedge of protection around them, that we know there's a lot of garbage that they could be exposed to, and we just pray that you'd shield them and build a hedge of protection, keep them safe, and remind them that to come home and visit us once in a while. Father, we pray for Tyler Engelbred and Jack Manny, that you continue to keep them safe, Father. We're so thankful for we have young men and women that are willing to stand up and defend our great country. And Father, we just pray that you continue to give them the strength and comfort that they need to ultimately defend our country. And Father, we pray for last but not least for sure, and that is Pastor Tom. We know he's having surgery tomorrow, and we just pray that you'd be with him and continue to that the surgery would go well and that it is nothing serious. And we just pray that people would remember him in prayer throughout the day and ultimately tomorrow morning. And we just pray that everything would go well there, Father. And Father, you know the needs and the wants and the requests of the people here. And Father, we just ask that you'd answer all the prayer requests here this morning. And we just pray that you'd bless this body that's represented here this morning by the singing and the reading of the word. And we pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
What if we turn to page 38? We'll do 1, 3, and 4. Birthday. Who?
Kim.
Oh, you got you. I know Kim has something to say.
I'm just happy.
Yeah, we all are.
She probably just turned 19 today.
Yeah.
Yeah. I know Kim's close to my age. She's a few years younger, but she's close.
So. Jack and Carla's anniversary.
Yeah, we'll get to that.
Okay.
We got to do the birthday. We can't sing them both together yet. We're not that good yet. Let's sing happy birthday to Kim.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, God bless you. Happy birthday to you.
Anniversaries. Now it's Carla and Jack. I know if Jack was here, he'd have something to say.
Me. Carol.
And who else?
Carol.
Carol's?
Yeah.
I'm not even going to say anything, so we'll just sing happy anniversary.
Happy anniversary, happy anniversary, happy anniversary, happy anniversary. Celebrating merrily our happy anniversary. Celebrating merrily our happy anniversary, and God bless you.
You know, my brother should be stoned for making this up, because it's very, very tough to sing when you're up here. So I think, you know, if it was up to me, whoever has the anniversary should come up and help us sing, because then they know what we go through. So, but no, I won't put you on a spot like that. Well, maybe some of you. How about page 581? We'll sing all of them. 581.
Those songs, Eddie?
I picked that one. I picked three of them, I think.
They're good songs. Every time we sing The Great Physician, I think of Mr. Ronnie. So, Mr. Ronnie, that's a great song.
Actually, my mother-in-law picked that one.
Yeah.
I can't take credit for all.
So, that is a good one. And it is no secret what God can do. You know, we were at, Herman did a wedding yesterday. Did his grandson, Kyle and Leah's, just had over 200 people there sharing the gospel with them. He did an amazing job. And I did a David and Afton Seeley's wedding yesterday. So a couple hundred people heard the gospel yesterday, and that was the message. It is no secret what God can do. He can pardon you. You know, if you've not accepted Christ as your Savior, today is the day of salvation. And I had a lot of people come up. Herman had a lot of people come up. And hopefully we'll get some new people to come and visit the church. And so it was a blessing. We also have the Craft and Bake Sale. It's not in the announcements, but we'll get it in there. The Craft and Bake Sale. The first weekend of deer hunting season, the women of the church are going to have a Craft and Bake Sale. So start getting your crafts ready, I guess. And probably not bake yet, but... they could practice. Yeah, okay. So, let's see here. We Majestic Pines today, Manor House today, Big Fork today, and we have Grand Village with Pastor Tom today. If you want to join any of those services today, you're more than welcome to come and join us. We have the Men's Advancement this coming Friday and Saturday, Friday night, Saturday. If you're going to join us, please email me. I've received about 4 emails, so we know how we can plan food, activities, and such. So if you're going to attend, please email me for the Men's Advancement Friday and Saturday morning, afternoon. And let's see here. Looks like that's about it for announcements. Is there anything I might have missed this morning? Yes, bud. Oh, yeah, okay. Sure, I missed some of the thanks. Kevin, Stocky, and Dennis, thanks for speaking. And we had Buddy and Lenore. Thank you guys for what you did. And Buddy wanted me to announce thanks to all the volunteers, people coming out and helping him at the swap meet. Raised a lot of money for the youth group, and that is a great thing. And Carol, what were you doing yesterday?
We had our family reunion
out at camp. Oh, excellent. Good. I'm glad you guys had a good time. Well, let's do our last song for the message. Yeah, Brian.
You
want
to give a heads up about the study?
Yes, I'm going to head up August 08/24. I'm going to head up, we'd say the 3rd or the 4th?
Fourth Wednesday.
I'm going to drive up to Big Fork and do a Bible study Wednesday night. So if some of the people in Big Fork want to join us, we are going to do it. Did we find a spot yet? There you go. So if you could email me the address and people up in Big Fork area, we're going to try to do Bible study once a month up there. And we're going to start with the book of John. And we're going to just kind of, if it's an hour, hour and a half, but we're going to try to study a book at a time. So we'll see how it goes. All right. Let's sing the last song before the message.
We have all the kids come up. We're going to sing this handout I give you, this Do Lord. So,
Lord, oh, do remember me. Lord, oh,
Rachel should come up and be with the kids.
She is a big kid.
A good friend of mine, he's been coming to church for the last year, Desmond, starts Hibbing Community College this Friday. And if you don't know Desmond, he's in the back, wears the Spurs hat. And should pray for him for that, but we won't. But anyways, starts college. So if you wish him good luck, keep him in prayers for sure. He's going to law enforcement program, so great for him. Just been a blessing to have him at the church this last year. And also a youth group. Is this the 21st? We'll do it up at Camp Ruby. Message is going to be on Elijah. So if you want to come, encourage your kids to come. So we're going to do more in-depth messages, so hopefully the kids can come and learn and grow. And so we're going to do it on Elijah. Let us turn over to Philippians. Chapter 4. Philippians is a prison epistle. Paul wrote it while he was in Rome there, I believe. And we go to chapter 4. The name of the message today is Rejoice in the Lord Jesus Christ. And the, I actually used 4:4. It says, rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say, rejoice. Let's open with a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, Father, first of all, we just, again, thankful for Christ. And it is no secret what Jesus Christ can do for us and others. He's the one that does offer us, he pardons us from our sins, and he offers us the gift of eternal life when we receive him, when we believe that he died on the cross for our sins and resurrected for us, we're born again. And Father, if there's anybody that's not accepted Christ, we just ask that you'd bless this message this morning and that the people would receive Christ, or whenever they watch it, Father, on the TV or YouTube, and that you'd use it to witness to others and people would receive Christ. And Father, to your children, that we would remember that we're to rejoice in the Lord. We're to rejoice in the Lord in all circumstances, that we'd be anxious for nothing in this world, because you know what, this is not our home. And we just ask that you'd bless this message, because it's first part of Philippians 4 is tremendous. And we just ask that the people would get something out of the message, your children would get something out of the message this morning. And we pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. So just before I went on vacation, our last message was called Enemies of the Cross of Christ. Paul's warning us to be aware of false prophets who preach works for salvation, rituals or sacraments for salvation. And he calls them some pretty tough words there in Philippians 3:2. He says he calls them dogs, calls them evil workers, and he calls them beware of the concision. So Philippians 3:18, he goes on to say, for many walk, of whom I have told you often and now tell you even weeping, that they are the enemies of the cross of Christ. In a recent article we wrote, the Good News Church here wrote in the local paper, I definitely received a little bit of hate mail. There were pretty some people offended by what we had to say about being a child of God, and actually compared us to radical jihadists. But you know what? I responded back in a loving, kindly manner and invited the person to church or even meet with him individually. But it's not my words. You know, it's what Jesus Christ said. There's only one way to heaven. You know, he's the one that come revealed himself in the flesh, and he's the one that went to the cross, and he's the one that paid the perfect sacrifice, and he's the one that resurrected. And these are his words. Yet people get offended when you say there's only one way to heaven. And it's truly sad, because you know what? Then they'll be spend their all eternity in hell with their sins paid for, because they wouldn't accept Christ Jesus as their Savior. You know, one day they're going to know Christ. And that's just too bad. You know, and that is the world today, that we need to be more tolerant, that we need to be more open-minded. We need to be free thinkers is what the world wants us to. And you know what? We need to stay biblically based and not politically correct, but biblically correct. So there are no man-made works, rituals, or sacraments that will save you. And that is the reason why Jesus Christ came to the cross. That's why he revealed himself in the flesh, so he could die for our sins. That, to me, that is the greatest message I'll ever hear, and is the greatest message we could ever share with anybody. So when you read the scriptures, we are clearly warned over and over that we must beware of false prophets. We know the churches today that, you know, maybe 4 years ago, 5 years ago, that people would say, oh, you got to be worried about, you know, the gays coming in the church. No, that's not what the problem is. You know, gays can be saved just like you and I. They're sinners just like you and I. They need to receive Christ just as you and I. You know who we need to be aware of? If you look according to the scriptures, you need to beware of false prophets, false teachers of the gospel. Those are the people we need to be aware of. People that preach works for salvation, or they add, say they're saved by faith, but then they add on little things like, you got to go to church. Your life's got to show it. You got to become a church member. And these are scriptures that I wanted to review, because this is what we need to be reminded of. And ultimately, I look to the pastors. People reading and teaching the Word of God, that's who we need to be wary of. People that call themselves priests or pastors or reverends or this or that, they have responsibility. And some of the garbage that's taught in the papers, local papers, and or in the churches is just sad. And I can't believe people would allow themselves to be exposed to that garbage. So 1 Timothy 4, 1 through 3 tells us, and we are in this time. It says, now the Spirit speaketh expressly that in later times some shall depart from the faith. Paul speaking here to the young man, young pastor Timothy, pastor of Ephesus, giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils, speaking lies and hypocrisy, having their conscience seared with a hot iron, justifying their works of salvation, justifying their sacraments or rituals, what they're trying to save that saves people. That's having their conscience seared, forbidding to marry and commanding to abstain from meats, which God had created to be received with thanksgiving of them which believe and now and know the truth. Turn over to 2 Timothy 4. And the reason we review this is because Philippians is a warning to believers up in Philippi. And it is a clear warning to us today, because we are just like living in Macedonia or in Galatia, that we need to be aware of false messages slipping in. 2 Timothy 4, 3 and 4 says, for the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine. Had a lady approach me at the wedding yesterday, and she's like, really enjoyed the message. Like that you read out of the Bible. So many pastors today won't even pick up the Word of God today. And there's nothing better than hearing the Word of God. Endure sound doctrine, but after their own lust shall they heap to themselves teachers having itchy ears. They shall turn away their ears from the truth and shall be turned unto fables. We are living there in these times. Galatians chapter 6 or chapter 1. And we need to remember, like this building here, a place that our kids and grandkids will come and hear the gospel, because I can guarantee that the gospel is going to continually just fade away. Sound doctrine is not going to be heard many years from now. And we need to make sure that this place, we have a place where our kids can come and hear the gospel, our grandkids can come and hear the gospel, or their spouses or their kids. And that's why it's important that we come and support a gospel preaching ministry. Galatians 1:6 says, I marvel that you are so soon removed from him that called you into the grace of Christ unto another gospel, which is not another, but there be some of trouble you and would pervert the gospel of Christ. But though we are an angel from heaven, preach any other gospel unto you than that which we have preached unto you, let him be accursed. Believing churches, they actually have people that come within And ultimately, that false message starts to creep in. It will happen. The elders have not had to have that happen here yet, but you know, we as a group are going to have to meet one day and we're going to like, okay, we're going to have to sit this person down and talk to them, whatever. It's going to happen. But we need to be, our ears need to be open to that. We always need to be listening for a message that could be a false message. We're to be wary of false teachers and stick to the teachings of Christ out of the Bible. All glory goes to Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ is to be magnified. He is to be rejoiced. And that's what the message is all about today, is about him being rejoiced. Why is Christ to be rejoiced and not men? Well, turn over to 1 Corinthians chapter 1. And we're going to get into it about what Christ has done for us. Because he's our all in all. He's done everything. We receive everything in Christ. But ultimately, the most important thing is salvation. 1 Corinthians 1, 17 and 18. For Christ sent me not to baptize, but to preach the gospel, not with the wisdom of words, lest the cross of Christ should be made none effect. Let people know, if they want to reject Christ, they're going to hell. People need to hear it. 18, for the preaching of the cross to them that perish, foolishness. But unto us which are saved, it is the power of God. To us, it is everything. To the saved, to the believers, it is everything. Because you know what? Without the cross of Christ, without the cross of Calvary, we are all hell-doomed sinners. If you turn over to Romans 1:16. And most of you already know these verses. But like Paul said in chapter 3, it's good to review this stuff. He says, for I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. Not ashamed is a great part, but I like the part for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth. That's why we are to rejoice in the Lord. Rejoice because he is the one that provided a way for us at the cross of Calvary, him dying on the cross for sins and resurrecting for us. Galatians 6:14 says, but God forbid that I should glory except in the cross of our Lord Jesus. And when he brings it up here, Galatians 6:14, it is a tremendous verse. Galatians 6:14. But God forbid that I should glory except in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ. That's where we should be glorying. By whom the world is crucified unto me and I unto the world. There's nothing better than knowing that Jesus Christ died on the cross for sins and resurrected for us. So that is what Jesus Christ, that's why we are to rejoice. So let's, now we've laid a foundation. So let's go on to Philippians chapter 1. I'm sorry, chapter 4, verse 1. And you're going to see the love that Paul has towards his family here in Philippi. It is the same love we are to have for each other because we are all brothers and sisters in Christ if you've received Christ. And so many, there's so much here, but we'll just start in verse 1. It says, therefore, my brethren, dearly beloved and longed for, my joy and crown, so stand fast in the Lord, my dearly beloved. See, Paul truly cared and loved the believers in Jesus Christ. See, as a dad, there's nothing more important than his family. My wife and kids are the world to me, and this is my physical family. So I want you to look at this as a spiritual family and then a physical family, and the parallels of a physical family and a spiritual family. As a believer in Jesus Christ, we have another family, and that's our family of believers, for we all have the same dad, which is our Father in heaven, and that is the family of faith. The same family Paul had is the same family we have. And you can see the tender mercies Paul had for his family, for he truly cared and loved for his family. Paul wasn't always with them. Went to Philippi 3 times. Twice, I believe, he went. Not 3 times. He went to Galatia 3 times. But anyways, wasn't always with them. However, he prayed for them. He had fellowship with them through the gospel of Jesus Christ. And as a dad, you know, you never want your wife or children to be hurt. I would never want, I would have a hard time if someone hurt my daughter, you know, not retaliating. As a dad, you don't want your wife or children to be hurt. And that's exactly what Paul's talking about here. See, Paul in chapter 3 is warning his brothers and sisters in Christ to be wary of dogs, wary of evil workers, concision, for these people were not family. And they come to destroy the family. Paul had a longing to see his brothers and sisters in Christ. And as mothers and fathers, we have a longing to see our children when they grow, when they're gone. And ultimately, when we look forward to spending time with them when they come home. And the same should be for our spiritual family. It's the same. We long to see other believers in Christ on our vacation. I longed to see some people. I mean, you know, thinking of individuals on the trip, I wanted to see them again. But what brings families together? The reason families usually come together is they have the same values and belief system. Our spiritual family has this same value and belief system. For the epicenter of our value and belief system is Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ redeemed us by his blood. He paid the perfect sacrifice for sins. He became sin for all of us. He became a curse for all of us. He died and was buried for us, and he resurrected for our justification. Jesus Christ is the center of this family. And if you want to be a member of this family, the same member of Paul's family, you must believe Jesus Christ died on the cross for your sins, burial, and resurrection. There's only one way to heaven, and it's believing the finished work of Christ. Paul's joy was in his family, the family of believers, for he is the one who shared the gospel of Jesus Christ with them in Philippi, and because of this, they were his crowns. The people of Philippi were riches to Paul, for nothing compared to sharing the gospel of Christ and winning souls for Jesus Christ. Soul winning, or adding new members to the family, is the most valuable thing to Paul. They are his crowns. And you see that there, my joy and crown. Paul is encouraging his family to stand by the Lord, for it is by the Lord one is delivered. First, our Lord Christ gives us salvation when we believe, and when what he's done for us. And also the Lord delivers us daily, for we'll be miserable without the Lord. And ultimately, when we get our mind off of Christ, that's when we could possibly fall for false doctrine. And so it's a reminder here of these dogs, evil workers, and concision. He's reminding them. So just like you, having a yearning to hear from your kids and being with your kids, our Father and our Savior also has a yearning to be in fellowship with you. Just think, as a mom and dad, I would be heartbroken if my son didn't call me or my daughter didn't visit me. I would be heartbroken. And how many parents here would be heartbroken if their sons and daughter never called them after they left? That's the same as our Heavenly Father and our Savior. He wants to have communication with you. He wants to talk to you. He wants you to pray to him, and he wants to communicate back to us through his word. That is the fellowship that we can have in every single day. So as kids to our Father in heaven, let us be respectful and listen to his words and remain in fellowship with him. So verse 2, he says, I beseech Eutychus, I beseech Syntyche, and they be of the same mind in the Lord. See, Syntyche and Eutychus were children of the Lord and were causing dissension in the family. Causing dissension in the family. And we see that happen in the family sometimes. What was the dissension they were causing? We don't really know, but I believe it was related to a false message, just as in chapter 3. They probably fell for a false message and now were causing problems within the family. The same mind in the Lord is keeping true to biblical teachings and not fall for false teachings that preach rituals, sacraments, or works for salvation. Rituals, sacraments, or works for salvation message is not a message that has the same mind as the Lord. The same mind in the Lord is remembering who did what and remembering who we are. Jesus Christ did all the work. And ultimately, he is the one that holds on to us. He is the one that gives us eternal life. He was the one that grants us enough grace each and every day to get us through the day. The same mind in the Lord is getting our minds off ourselves and getting it on to others, and ultimately sharing the gospel with them, being kind to them, and having compassion to them. Philippians 4:3. He says, and I entreat thee also, true yoke fellow, Help those women which labored with me in the gospel, with Clement also, and with other my fellow laborers whose names are in the book of life. So Paul's reaching out here to someone at Philippi who has labored or yoked up for the gospel of Christ. Paul is asking this person to reach out and help these two women who are sisters in Christ. But he wants them to give them some godly counsel. Help these women get their mind back on Christ. These women helped Paul spread the gospel of Christ and now had some problems, which we think is related to false teachings. And Paul's asking someone to meet with them, meet with these women, and set them straight. This person has reached out to Clement also and other fellow laborers for the gospel of Christ and make sure they keep their mind on Christ. It's a constant reminder and just re-emphasizes the importance of us hearing the gospel, because Philippians 3:1 was a tremendous verse. It says, "Family, my brethren, rejoice in the Lord. To write the same things to you, to me indeed is not grievous, but for you it is safe." It's important we hear this message over and over what Christ did for us. We need to be reminded daily that we keep our mind on Christ, for it is easy to fall out of fellowship. We are to stand fast in the Lord, stand by the Lord every day, and we do this by reading his word, praying, and having fellowship with other believers. And ultimately, whose names, and R is italicized, so it's not in the original text, but it says, whose names in the book of life. And I have a question here. It says, who doesn't see confidence in these reads? For it is complete confidence of eternal security here, knowing that these people's names are in the book of life. Some of you might say, what is the book of life? But here, I just want to emphasize again, names in the book of life. What is the book of life? Let's take a few seconds here and just review what it is. It is a place where your names, before the foundation of the earth was laid, before the foundation of the earth, before God blew stars into existence, spoke stars and the earth into existence, or spoke life into man, the books were written. Two books. The Lamb's Book of Life, and ultimately, the books. And your name was already in one or the other before the foundation of the earth was laid. And if you've received Christ, your name is in the Lamb's Book of Life. God already knew if you would accept. He never predestined anybody to those books, but he knew if you would accept Christ or not, and your name was already in those books. So the book of life is a place where your name has been written, signifying you are a believer in Christ. You are guaranteed inheritance into heaven. You believe Jesus Christ died on the cross for your sins, burial and resurrection. You trust in Jesus Christ for salvation and him alone. Your name is in the book of life. The book of life, if you turn over to Revelations 3:5, the book of life is complete assurance, knowing you'll be in heaven one day, and it is not because anything you've done, but because everything what Christ has done for you. He says, he that overcometh. And we're going to look at the word overcometh here because the Bible always gives us the answer. He that overcometh, the same shall be clothed in white raiment. So his righteousness. And I will not blot out his name out of the book of life, but I will confess his name before my Father and before his angels. So this verse is eternal security. It is complete assurance. Now let's get an answer on the overcometh, because some people pervert that ultimately into doing works. 1 John chapter 5 gives us the answer of what overcoming is. 1 John 5, verses 4 and 5 says, "For whatsoever is born of God overcometh the world. And this is the victory that overcometh the world, our faith. Who is he that overcometh the world, but he that believeth that Jesus is the Son of God?" That's who overcometh. Is the ones that believe that Jesus Christ died on the cross for their sins, trusting in the Son of God, believing what he did at the cross of Calvary. You know what? It is the believers who are written in the Lamb's Book of Life. And we know non-believers are not written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Turn over to Revelations 13:8. "And all that dwell upon the earth shall worship him." This is the Antichrist, the beast, whose names are not written in the book of life of the Lamb, slain from the foundation of the world. During the tribulation time, they will follow Satan, the Antichrist, and their names are not written in the book of life. Turn over to Revelation 17:8. The beast that thou sawest was and is not, and shall ascend out of the bottomless pit and go into perdition. And they that dwell on earth shall wonder, whose names were not written in the book of life from the foundation of the world. God already knows who's going to receive Christ or not. Have you received him? Which book is your name written in? Let's continue to read. Keep turning to the right. Revelation 21:27. Says, and there shall be no wise enter into it anything that defile, neither whatsoever worketh abomination maketh a lie, but they which are written in the Lamb's book of life. That means enter into heaven. Only the people who are written in the Lamb's book of life will enter into heaven. Look at Revelation 22:19. And if any man shall take away from the words of the book of life of this prophecy, God shall take away his part out of the book of life and out of the holy city and from the things which are written in this book. So ultimately, this Bible is salvation freely received by faith in the finished work of Christ. If you turn over to look at John chapter 20, this book, what the book is all about, you can look at John chapter 20. I think it's 31. It says, but these are written that you might believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing you might have life through his name. That's what this book is all about. So when you want to add to what Christ did or take away what Christ did, that means work, believing in works for salvation, rituals or sacraments. That means not trusting in the finished work of salvation, not trusting in the finished work of Christ. Your name is not written in the Lamb's book of life because you're adding to what the scriptures are saying. You're not trusting in what the Bible is teaching. So if you believe not the record that God gave of his son, your name's not written in the book of life. And the books were opened, and ultimately, which book is your name in? Paul is giving encouraging words here to the Philippians and letting us all know we cannot lose our salvation. Once a family member, always a family member. And we need to care for each other. And when one falls for a false message, we need to reach out and help them out. We do. Philippians 4:4. Rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say rejoice. And it's an emphasis, ultimately, a continuation of Philippians 3:1. It says, finally, my brethren, rejoice in the Lord. This is a tough one. But ultimately, we need to remember this. And I say, in every circumstance, we are to rejoice in the Lord. The Philippians and us are reminded in life and or death, we are to magnify Christ. Philippians 1:20 says, we are to magnify Christ. Jesus Christ is our salvation. He is our Redeemer. He is our Sanctifier. He is eternal life. He's the one that offers peace. He is our hope. His blood offered a perfect sacrifice for sin. He is propitiation. He is the Good Shepherd. He is the Great Shepherd. He is the Chief Shepherd. He is the Rock of Salvation. He is the Foundation. He is the Fruit Bearer. He is the Tree of Life. He is the one that holds the keys to heaven and to hell. Jesus Christ is our all in all. And that's why we are to rejoice in Jesus Christ. Rejoice in the Lord. We are to rejoice in Jesus Christ, for he offers sufficient grace each day for us to live and to overcome all circumstances. Rejoice in the Lord always. In every circumstance, we need to rejoice in the Lord. When your circumstances look dark and unbearable, we're to rejoice in the Lord. I had a friend email me, and not that I want to share what she shared, but a family member of hers was dying. And ultimately, she's losing hope. And we conversed back and forth a little bit about it, and I'm like, you know what? We know her mom is saved. And maybe there's somebody in that woman's life that needs to hear the gospel. And it is only at the lady's funeral, or maybe through this woman going through what she's going through, her friend or family member will receive Christ. And that's ultimately, the Lord knows all things. And he does all things out of love. And he does all things out of good. So you know what? Maybe our circumstances sometimes are selfish and we're like, why me? But ultimately, we should be like, why not me? Because, you know, maybe it is the Lord's using you, your sickness, your circumstance, for the people that you're working with or the family members that are watching you. Maybe by how you handling it, well, ultimately, lead that person to Christ. So when your circumstances look dark, unbearable, and we are to give our burdens to Christ and rejoice, for he will give us sufficient grace for the day. He will. When circumstances look bright and joyful, and we do not do this enough in America, because you know, when things are good, we don't need God. When your circumstances are bright and joyful, things are looking good, we need to rejoice in the Lord and be thankful for that. No matter the situation, no matter the circumstance, we need to be reminded, rejoice in the Lord. Verse 5 says, let your moderation be known unto all men, the Lord is at hand. We know the rapture's near. We know the rapture is also known as the day of Christ. We read this over in Philippians 1, 6 and 10. It says, being confident of this very thing, that that he which hath begun a good work in you would perform it until the day of Jesus Christ. Guaranteeing our inheritance. He's the one that's holding on to us. Eternal life right there. And then 10, that you may approve things that are excellent, that you may be sincere without offense till the day of Christ, that we not be a stumbling block to the lost or out to other believers. But we are a family and our Father is in heaven, and soon Jesus Christ will be coming for us. Our conduct should be humble. That's what moderation is. Our conduct should be meek. Our behavior should point others to Christ. See, men lost and saved should not look at other believers and see what we boast. See that we boast in our own works. But that we boast in the finished work of Christ. We rejoice in Jesus Christ. The Lord is at hand, for he looks upon us daily, and someday he will return in the rapture all believers to heaven before the tribulation starts. And 6, some of you have this memorized. It says, be careful for nothing, or be anxious for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God. See, believers are to be anxious for nothing of this world. We should be anxious for nothing. And this was a reminder for me. Because on the vacation, I didn't get to read as much as I wanted to. And ultimately, I was becoming anxious for my new job. And then studying this last night, I'm like, you know what? And then Jenny giving me words of encouragement. I realized, you know what? I don't need to be anxious for nothing. It'll work out. It always does. But I need to be anxious for nothing of this world, for none of this will last. There are a few things that last eternally, and this is what we should invest in. There are a few things that will last eternally, and these are the things that we should invest in. It is Jesus Christ. He will last forever. He's always been, and he always will. He's the Alpha and the Omega. And we should invest in the Word of God, reading the Word of God. That's because we know the Word of God will never end. The earth will end one day, but the Word of God, he tells us in Matthew, will never end. And you know what? Investment in people. Sharing the gospel. You know what it's about? Soul winning. Investing in people. Those are the three things we shouldn't be investing in. If you are a believer and you want to support a ministry that invests in Jesus Christ, invests in the Word of God, invests in people to hear the gospel, I'm telling you, this is a private place. This is a great investment. We don't talk a lot about money at this church, but you know what? Ultimately, it is a grace giving. It is between you and the Lord. And that's what you're investing in here. So let us be anxious for nothing and rejoice in Christ. If you have doubts, if you have wants, if you have needs, in every situation, we are to pray. Every situation, we are to pray. Make your prayer requests to our Heavenly Father every day, every situation. And we have this privilege of accessing the Father. Why? Because everything what Christ did for us. So many people think, and they know I debate this, before you're saved, I don't know where your prayers go. I truly believe it is when you are saved, those prayers, that is when you have access to the Father. People say, well, I believe that, you know, I prayed for people to share the gospel. I believe that's God's grace. He already has, from the original time, he already had that get the gospel out there. People want to hear the truth. That was automatically his grace. But until you're saved, you have access to the Father through Jesus Christ. And that is a privilege we receive. So that's why we know what we should make our prayer requests known to him, our dad. So in every situation, be anxious for nothing. Let your prayer requests be known unto the Father, and be thankful that we have access to the Father through Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ is our mediator. If you pull up 1 Timothy 2:5, tells us that. He is our intercessor. And he mediates and he intercesses on our behalf every day. Every day. 1 Timothy 2:5 says, there is one God and one mediator between God and man, the man, Christ Jesus. And then you go to Hebrews 7:25. It says, wherefore he is able to save them to the uttermost that God that come unto God by him, seeing he ever liveth to make intercession for them. See, we often carry our burdens ourselves. And we do not bring our requests, our supplications, and our prayers daily to our Father in heaven. And the Bible here is very clear. It says, make your requests, make your supplications, and your prayers daily to the Father in heaven. It is interesting that it says, made known unto God at the end there. Made known unto God. Does not say made known unto men. Bring your requests, your supplications, your prayers to our Father in heaven every day. You can ask others to pray for you, but remember, we don't bring our prayer requests to men because we go directly to the source. We go directly to the one that can help. We go directly to the one that can answer our prayer requests. We go to the one that gives us the sufficient grace of the day to handle whatever comes in our path. That we may be rejoiced in the Lord when we're diagnosed with a horrible disease. That we may be rejoiced in the Lord that if somebody, a family member dies, that we could be a light in this dark world. We go directly to the one that can answer our requests, answer our supplications, and answer our prayers. And then the last verse today is in Philippians. His chapter is verse 7. It says, and the peace of God, which passes all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Jesus. If you turn over to Romans chapter 5, verse 1. Peace with God, we read that in Philippians 4:7. It says, therefore, being justified, pardoned, justified by faith, with peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. So looking at that verse and going back to Philippians 4:7. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ. See, we have peace with God through Christ. This surpasses all understanding in that there is no natural man that will understand the peace that is offered in the blood of Jesus Christ. See, just like in 1 Corinthians 1:17, to the ones that perish, the cross is foolishness. But unto us that are saved, it is everything. And here's what I write for the last thing. It says, we are to rejoice in Jesus Christ, for he reminds us we have peace from all condemnation for our names. The believers in Jesus Christ, our names are written in the book of life. And no matter what happens in this world, we know we have eternal life. We know we will spend eternity in heaven because of what Jesus Christ has done for us. That is why we are to rejoice in the Lord. Let's close in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, Father, again, we're just so thankful for Jesus Christ sending your Son to the cross, dying a death that we all owe. But we could never make a perfect sacrifice. That's why Christ, God from eternity past, had to reveal himself in the flesh and go to the cross of Calvary, turn the cross into an altar, and ultimately the perfect Lamb shedding his blood for the payment of sin and dying. So the whole world witnessed that Jesus Christ died. There's no question. There's a Roman guard put outside his tomb so they would have nobody to steal his body, the Jews thought. But ultimately the Roman guard proving that his body wasn't stolen. And the third day, his resurrection, the angel opening the tomb, not to let Jesus out, but to let the world in, to show that Jesus had resurrected, that he's ascended. The payment for sin is paid in full, and there's nothing else left to do except believe, trust in him and him alone. And it's so amazing, Father, all the things that we receive in Christ. And ultimately, one of the things that we receive is a new family. A family of faith. A dad who's in heaven. A dad that wants to have fellowship with us every single day. A dad that wants to hear our prayer requests, our supplications every single day. And as a dad, don't we want our children to come to us and say, Dad, you know, can you help me with this? And as a dad, I tell you what, there's nothing better than helping your children. And I know that's how it is in heaven, that the Father and our Savior want to help us every single day. Jesus wants to mediate and intercess on our behalf every single day. And we are to be anxious for nothing. Because you know what? This world will end someday. And let all of our prayer requests be known unto our dad in heaven every single day. So if there's anything that people get out of this, hopefully they get to make all their wants and wishes known to their dad every single day. And Father, we're just so thankful for all the family members that you brought out today. We just pray that you'd be with the men, women, speaking, singing, playing at the senior living centers today, that the message would get out. If anybody wants to come join us in any of those places, they're more than welcome. And we will be starting Acts chapter 1 over at Majestic Pines. And Father, we just ask that if we don't see anybody, we just ask that you bring us all back next week, where we can continue to give glory to you. And we pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. We'll sing our last song.
Everybody stand and turn to page 314.